So my name is Keisha Findley, and I'm a postdoctoral research fellow at the National Human Genome Research Institute at the National Institutes of Health in Bethesda, Maryland. Well, I study fungi and bacteria on skin. We're covered in them. They're everywhere in the environment. They surround us. So I actually grew up in the Maryland area in Tacoma Park. I had a teacher in high school, a biology teacher, freshman year, and she was absolutely amazing. I think because of her, I am where I am today because she made science fun. She made it something that you could understand and you actually wanted to learn more. Whereas I feel like some teachers in high school don't really do that. And just having that foundation, a very solid and strong foundation, it's easier to build upon that once the foundation is there. The foundation is not there, you can't build upon it. It's gonna take a lot longer. So I've pretty much been in science for a really long time. My mom is a nurse, and so it's pretty much been ingrained in me that medicine and kind of taking care of people is important and really helping people through your work. I remember reading a paper one day on the gut microbiome. So looking at bacteria in the gut and how in a lean person versus an obese person, there are different types of communities of bacteria that live in the gut that can shape how a person is able to break down their food products and basically store that food as energy or store it as fat. And so from that point on, I told myself that I would work on the microbiome. So when it was time for me to finish up graduate school, I looked for a postdoc position. And so I applied to this fellowship program at NIH. So I've been here for about 5 years, working on skin microbiome work. So within the field, it's called the microbiome, which is basically the study of all of the microbes and their genes in or on the human body. So we're really interested in looking at what bugs are on you. Baseline, what do the microbes on your skin look like? And how it basically keeps you healthy when the communities are happy. And then when there's some sort of shift, whether that be because you've taken antibiotics, because you have a cold or something, some sort of bacterial infection, and that can completely change the types of bacteria or fungi that are residing on your skin or even in your gut, and then that can create some sort of disease state. And that's what happens in an individual who has to undergo a fecal transplant. They've been on a course of antibiotics that totally wipes out all the good bacteria in their gut. And because it wipes out the good bacteria, the bad bacteria are able to grow. And that causes diarrhea and really bad infections and could lead to death if it goes untreated. And there has been research where they've taken feces from one individual and transplanted that into another person who has a really bad gut disorder, which could potentially kill them. And so they give them this bolus of poop that has bacteria in it, and it actually cures the person. There's about 80 to 85% success rate, and it's called a fecal transplant. And the reason it works is because we now understand what bacteria are in our gut and how they're actually helping to keep us healthy, how they can also cause disease, and how those communities shift, that can also create disease. And so because we have that information, we're able to take bugs from one person and transplant it into someone else, and that could actually cure someone of a disorder. So there's a physician in Canada who's desiccating down the poop sample, basically, to a powder, essentially, and putting that in a pill form and having people swallow. But you have to take 20 to 30 of the pills in order for it to actually offer protection and cure you of that bacterial infection. They're actually doing the work now to really tease apart what it is in the poop that's curing people. In the lab, for a lot of the microbiome experiments, we're basically sampling from healthy adults or sometimes individuals who have diseases or some sort of disorder. So a normal day-to-day for me is basically getting the samples that we brought up from the NIH. Some of the participants, as I said, either have leg ulcers or some don't. So this is what a tube would look like, and inside the tube is a swab. So this is an image showing plates that we actually cultured from healthy human skin. So these are all fungi from different participants in the study. This is a plate of the heel, toenail, nose, back, and toe web. And this is what we would call a yeast. And that was found in the nose of one of the participants, and we all pretty much have that in our nose because we breathe in mold spores all the time, which don't cause us any harm because we're pretty healthy. So we use a really long swab to basically sample from the skin. We take that swab and we put it into a small microcentrifuge tube, and we incubate in this shaker at 37 degrees for an hour. And then after that, we do a couple shaking steps. And so this is for mechanical disruption to really help break apart the cells, the bacterial and fungal cells that are in the tube. And so we place it on here and we shake it, and beat basically for about 10 minutes at really high speed. This is what it sounds like, and it just shakes for 10 minutes. This is a particular fungal isolate that's found in people who have foot infections. And so it was really interesting to see that we were actually able to recover that from this participant. And then on the back, we have Malassezia, which is actually the most dominant fungus on the human skin. It basically represents 50 to 80% of total skin fungi. So it's pretty much all over us. We all have it. And then after that, we add in some additional reagents to kind of help really pull out the DNA that's been released from the cells. And at the very end, you have this tube with your DNA in it. So it should have your bacterial DNA as well as your fungal DNA in this tube. But then what about someone who has acne or has some other skin disorder like psoriasis or rosacea or eczema, for example? What does it look like in that individual, and how can we use that information to basically help treat that person? So this is DNA that's been isolated from one of our patient samples so that we can then do PCR to amplify regions that are specific to the bacteria and regions that are specific to the fungi, so we can use those regions to identify what's in our sample. This kind of work requires a lot of sequencing, a lot of manpower to actually do the processing of your samples.
And how many more patients do you have left to see?
For the microbiome study, it's only going to be about maybe 6 more with leg ulcers, hopefully.
Okay.
And then the data analysis part, which means you spend a lot of time in front of a computer doing analysis. And that can take anywhere from weeks to months to actually complete your analysis, because you can generate up to 5 million sequences, depending on how many participants you have, how many samples you've sequenced. The public is what I think really excites me, is just being able to talk to students, parents about what I do, and just get everyone excited about the microbes, because they're here and they're not going anywhere. And really, they outnumber our human cells by 10 to 1. So we're pretty much 10% human, 90% fungi, bacteria, viruses, archaea, etc. So we have to love them because they're here. We're only just beginning, and there's so much more to explore. Never let anyone tell you you can't do it, because I've had people in the past tell me that I couldn't, and I didn't listen. I just kept moving forward and realized that this was something that I was interested in, and if I wanted it, I could definitely achieve it. But just know that there will be people who will come into your life and tell you that you can't, and just silence them, don't listen, and move forward. If you want it, you work hard, and you will be rewarded. It won't be easy, but it's worth it.